Hello, I'm Diane Trees. Human expertise and decades of experience make WFTV Channel 9 meteorologists some of the most skilled in the nation. What goes into making those crucial advisory decisions that keep us all glued to our TV sets in the hours before a storm makes landfall? Joining us now is WFTV Chief Meteorologist Tom Terry. Tom, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Why does the National Hurricane Center, why issue a forecast for a season? Why not just wait till storms happen and then you track them?
I think we all want to know what's going to happen in advance, right? I mean, I could always just give you tomorrow's forecast and let you guess at the next 5 to 7 days, but we try to give you the best idea what we think might happen over the next 6 months, but it's hard to do.
Right. How accurate have those forecasts then become?
It depends on the year. We've had some anomaly years, like 2005, we had, 28 named storms. It was kind of one of these oddball years. And then we followed that up with some really quiet years. So it has gotten a little bit better, but it's all kind of based on statistics, most of it. So kind of hard to find the balance sometimes.
Your years of experience and your expertise, when you get the season's forecast, do you make tweaks? Or do you make notes of things you want to watch?
Generally speaking, I don't pay a lot of attention to the exact numbers there because it only takes one storm. You know, if we would only have had Katrina back in 2005, it would still be a memorable year. But Katrina had a lot of company that year. We only had Andrew, basically, back in 1992. We had a handful of other storms. But sometimes it's just that one storm that we pay attention to. So the total number of storms, we could have 20, but if they all go out in the open Atlantic, then, you know, we're okay.
What inputs go into the number of storms then? How does that come about?
Well, they take a look at a lot of global factors, like in the Pacific Ocean, believe it or not, it has a lot of impacts on the Atlantic Ocean. We're all tied together around the world. El Nino, La Nina, these two phenomenons over there can impact our hurricane season. We don't think we'll have much impact from those this year, as an example. The water temperatures, the warmer the water, the more active storms can get. Is there a lot of wind shear? Are the winds blowing rapidly? How strong are the high and low pressure areas? A lot of things like that.
So it's almost a global effect that you're looking to determine the number of storms that we're going to have.
It's very global, but it also changes every single day. There's only so much you can glean 3, 4, 5, 6 months out.
Well, then let me ask you this. First, what is the time frame for the typical hurricane season?
Usually starts June 1st. Probably over 95-96% of all of our named storms, tropical storms that may become a hurricane, have between June 1 and the end of November. So that's our 6-month season, if you will. We can have storms afterward. But for the most part, we wait till we get to August and September. That's usually when we see a big spike in the average number of storms.
So that's the most typically mm-hmm. the most active season. Now this year, I believe we had a storm form in April.
We did. It was Arlene. We had a very rare early season storm. And we've actually had storms in every month of the year, but generally they're relatively weak until we get to the peak of the season.
When you have a storm form like that early, does that give any indication what the season's going to be like, or does that not matter?
Not necessarily. It's just kind of an anomaly. But we have seen more of these little spurious storms develop, but we also have much better remote sensing ability. We can see a lot of things now that we couldn't necessarily see a couple hundred years ago.
So what's the technology that you're using now?
Satellites are big. We just launched a brand new GOES-R, which is now GOES-16. It's going to be over the East Coast. So we'll essentially have, when you're sitting at home, you probably won't notice that much of a difference, but we'll have a lot more data that our meteorology and hurricane forecasters can use to look at a storm. Supercomputers are really super cool. And I think the biggest advancement we've had in the last 10, 20 years has certainly been our computing horsepower, being able to get finer and finer resolution. And we're still working to tweak the forecast models, but that's been our single biggest improvement.
Do you have to go back to school to keep up with all of this?
We always keep up on this. Now, I don't necessarily go back to school, but we'll have seminars around the country. There are all kinds of online courses. Back when we were in college, we didn't have any of this online course stuff, right? I had to find a book somewhere in the library. But now there's all sorts of online coursework. We get daily email updates. The American Meteorological Society sends us all kinds of stuff.
If you're tech savvy, I imagine that helps a little. Or maybe you've become tech savvy
tech savvy.
Yes. I think living in Florida, too, most of us are familiar with the spaghetti lines that mm-hmm. come in the cone of uncertainty.
Right.
How do you analyze which of those numerical models that you're going to choose to give the best prediction.
When we first started with spaghetti models back in 2004, it's kind of a new concept. And some of those little spaghetti lines you see on there are really very poor guidance models for what's going on. But now what we'll do is we'll take like four or five of the best models and we'll kind of blend them together and come up with like an ensemble. And there are actually a couple of little spaghetti lines, just a few, that are kind of like a good first estimate that the National Hurricane Center will actually use. So I don't show just 40 lines on the map anymore because that doesn't mean anything. I handpick a couple of good ones. The European model is still probably the best global model. They just do a really good job with their modeling. The American GFS, but we have a few others that we blend together.
Now, do you change which of those models that you're going to choose depending on what the global conditions are year to year?
We'll generally use about the top four or five models, but sometimes you'll kind of know that, well, this model didn't get a good start on the storm, or maybe this one's a little too far north already. So if there are errors when it starts, then there's probably going to be errors later down the road.
So you can monitor all
of
that.
We're always checking to see how they initialize.
Now, we categorize our storms according to wind speed. Mm-hmm. What are the other factors that can impact how dangerous or potential damage of a storm? Do you watch all of that?
Oh, absolutely. And the Hurricane Center has done a great job. Before, we just had the Saffir-Simpson scale, category one all the way up through category five, but it didn't really tell us much about like the storm surge potential. It was simply just how much wind you might have. Now we pay as much attention to the storm surge potential as we do the wind, just the pure wind, because the winds impact the storm surge. With Matthew back in 2016, we had a record 11-foot storm surge up near Jacksonville. So we were adversely impacted a great deal, not necessarily from the winds, like blowing your house down, but from the water rushing up along the coast. So we have storm surge warnings now. We just started that last year.
Now, with the hurricane, obviously the storm surge, but flooding, anybody in Florida can be vulnerable to flooding. Are there flood maps? Do you watch that so you know when to issue a watch or a warning?
Right. Well, the National Weather Service, they have a whole hydrology department. So they're always looking at what the river levels are. They're looking at how much the different basins can hold. So they'll issue their own flood watches and advisories. You make a good point, though, too, is that it doesn't take a big major hurricane to get a lot of flooding. We've actually had storms that were depression or tropical storm or not even a classified storm and had over 2 feet of rain in parts of our East Coast. And I know Matthew brought almost a foot of rain to Cranes Roost Park in Altamont Springs. It flooded the parking lot.
Exactly. You are monitoring quite a few factors then when you're looking at a storm.
Oh, it's nonstop. It's the Super Bowl of weather, as I term hurricanes.
I think so. So there's a lot more to it than just looking at the wind. That's not the worst part of the storm. What other things? What do you key into when you're looking at what this storm really might mean? And you still don't want to alarm your audience.
It's a big balancing act because you definitely want people to evacuate the coast. I always say if you have to go over a bridge to get to your home, you're probably going to have to evacuate. And it's not because I'm afraid that the winds are going to necessarily blow your house down. It could, but it's that water, that surge coming on shore, and you might get trapped over there and not have anyone to be able to come and rescue. But I always pay attention to the right-hand quadrant of a storm. That's where we have the strongest winds, plus we add the movement of the storm. So it's kind of an additive wind effect. I really get concerned about storms again in the Gulf of Mexico because that generally puts us in that northeast quadrant. Tornadoes are much more likely. And, of course, we certainly hope we don't get a major hurricane hitting the state, but Tampa is one of these cities half below sea level.
Takes a thunderstorm there, and we have some flooding
exactly.
in that. Social media, then, is that a component that you take advantage of?
Huge component. Yes, when we were sitting back here a few years ago talking about hurricanes, it was just kind of coming into its own. But now social media, it's a great way for you to tell me what's going on where you are, sending storm reports, and a good way for us when you're on the move, you're trying to evacuate, we can always keep you advised.
So helpful, too, when your electricity goes out and you can still get onto the phone and have the tweets or whatever that come across. Now, have you ever flown out with a hurricane?
Hunters? I have not.
Do you want to?
If I knew that I probably wouldn't feel bad, motion sickness wise, I would absolutely love to. I just saw them recently
here
in Orlando,
right?
And it was actually the first time in, 27 years that I'd actually gotten up close to them. They'd always been in another city or I couldn't go. Yeah. But it's just, it's really neat to see the workhorse and the people, men and women who fly through those storms. It's remarkable what they do.
Their mission is the reconnaissance for the storms, mm-hmm. but they also do a lot of research. Mm-hmm. Are you monitoring everything then that they bring back in all of their missions?
Well, we have a lot of live data feeds that come into our weather computer boxes plus internet websites that we look at. So we can kind of see minute by minute, they send back these little observations, and we will literally be hunkered down over a monitor watching this. Oh, the wind speed just shifted. Oh, it's got a center, you know, so yeah. It's really kind of neat to see the data come in real time.
I would think that it would be exciting to go out with them, although I don't know whether I'm brave enough.
Yeah, especially the big planes, there's a lot of room in the back, but lots of seat belts. I'm like, I don't know.
So that data that they bring back, it's more sophisticated now. So I would imagine every year you get a little bit better at
a little bit better.
Yeah.
You know, and I think the data they can take now and put it into the computer forecast models. Mm-hmm. It's not just the planes that fly through the storm. It's the high altitude jets that fly around it,
yeah.
sampling the upper atmosphere. All that gets put into the forecast models. And what will we do without our forecast models?
Well, we depend on them, as you
yes.
say. So what do you think? What's Florida's chances for remaining relatively unscathed through another season?
You know, it's been so long since we've had a major. It was Wilma back October 24th of 2005, the last major hurricane to hit the
and
States.
You covered that.
I did. And we kind of thought that we were just going to keep getting this blitzkrieg of storms year after year, but it's been very quiet since then. So it's kind of like the deck is stacked against us, so to speak. So at any moment, we could fire things right back up.
And a lot of people don't
just
remember.
Just be ready. Just
yes.
be ready.
Yes, Tom, thank you so much.